101. Now, I am presenting this as a demo lecture. Well, according to the memo from the Office of the Vice President to Academic Affairs, this lecture is only for 10 minutes. But we will have a short quiz after this. Okay, in this lesson, you will learn what biomass and biomass residue are. How is biomass transformed to fuel? And then you will learn the most suitable form of fuel from biomass that is not yet used in the Philippines. What are biomass? Biomass are materials that comprise living things, plants and animals. It consists mainly of carbon and hydrogen, and they are the primary sources of fuel from decayed to fresh biomass. You know, coal and petroleum come from decayed biomass. We use fresh biomass, which can be, well, we dry it and use it as fuel. However, biomass materials are also sources of food, shelter, chemicals, you know, and useful materials, and this limits their use as the source of fuel. So using biomass wastes or residue is practical. Now, here is the chemistry part. The reaction is called combustion. And the chemical reactions are simple. C plus O2. Carbon plus oxygen equals CO2, but with a lot amount of heat. And then hydrogen plus 1/2 O2 becomes water and much heat. So this is the source of fuel. However, biomass have to be processed first because in raw form, they are inconvenient to handle and they emit toxic substances. Now be careful in using firewood. If you inhale it, becomes, toxic. So the most practical is to thermally process it. And this is achieved by gasification and pyrolysis. You can represent this. Very easy to perform. No? And we have the torrefaction part in pyrolysis. If you have pyrolysis, there are two parts. Heating to 300 is pyrolysis, or is torrefaction. No? And torrefaction actually will, it's like roasting coffee, no? Without air. What you get is a fuel that is, when transformed to pellets, becomes very useful fuel. And it is, available in the Philippines, especially leaves, coconut grass, rice hull, coconut waste, and other agricultural residues. No? The processing is very simple. No? And this is readily available in the Philippines. In general, the mass balance here is that if you have 100 units, 30 becomes gas, 70 is becomes the solid products, and 90% of the energy is retained. So it is very desirable. It is easily to grind. The heating value is improved. It does not absorb water, and it is homogeneous. So the process is simple, environmentally friendly, relatively low cost, and can be for a small or large scale. No? Okay, so, I'll give the quiz. The quiz is, yes or no, is torrefaction suitable for the Philippines? Yes or no? Of course, the answer is yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Jose. They say that teaching may be presented in many different ways, and one of them is music. So if I said earlier, we cannot imagine a world without oceans, I must add, we cannot also imagine a world without music. Our third finalist is Amy Lynn Dupo, Associate Professor 4 at the Institute of Biological Sciences at the College of Arts and Sciences in UP Los Baños. Dr. Dupo has been with the UP for 10 years, 6 years of which were spent as a member of the faculty. Her area of specialization is entomology. Here is Dr. Emeline Dupo with her entry for the course Bio 150 or Principles of Ecology.
Magandang hapon po. So as mentioned by our host, I came from the Institute of Biological Sciences in UP Los Baños. So my career began as a extension coordinator or an extensionist at the UPLB Museum of Natural History, wherein I spent my time as the GRO there. So whenever there are visitors, I'll be the one entertaining them. So my first training in education is actually with the museum. So at that time, I realized that in case I go into teaching, then I would need to merge those two together. So entomology is very important to us. Without the field of entomology, I feel I will not exist because my parents met because both of them are also entomologists. And I love entomology so much, the only person that I was attracted to is also an entomologist. So I therefore conclude my forever sa entomology. Okay, good afternoon. I'm Emeline Dupo, again from the Institute of Biological Sciences, UP Los Baños. Okay, so in a gist or in a nutshell, my aspiration in teaching is to provide my students, or rather I call them learners, as students are passive individuals in the classroom. So when I say learners, they are active participants in class. So I want my students to be provided with a different type of learning media, one with which combines extension and research altogether. So notice that we expect our students to become critical thinkers, creative. So that means the faculty also need to be critical thinkers and creative at the same time, because we have to set an example. So these are just some of the topics we discuss in ecology. So we work with the different realms of ecology, and we have non-classroom activities that allows our students to be very well involved in each of our topics. So I'll just briefly run over them. So we expect our students to express themselves creatively. So these are our ecology students. So they have an eco-amazing race after the course, summarizing all 11 exercises during the semester. So they have a cheering competition using ecological terms. So they are judged based on the way they could apply the concepts together, and they go through 11 stations, each exercise, a summary of the exercise for the whole of the semester. We are lucky to have Mount Makiling as our playground. So we have the laboratory activities in Mount Makiling. So notice that we have several avenues. If we need an aquatic ecosystem, we simply go to our backyard. We have the Mulawin Creek. If we need a forest and a grassland microsite, we have Mount Makiling. We have an ASEAN heritage site just beside our classroom. So the class minus the room is equal to active participatory learning. But sir, please do not forget, baka po mag-apply kami ng for additional classroom, sabihin nyo, okay lang na walang classroom sa Los Baños. We do need more classrooms, sir. But we would like them to experience active field engagement, because we are training biologists, ecologists, so we cannot simulate that inside a classroom. We need to go out, provided we have waivers, insurance, every field trip, because we cannot simulate actual marine ecosystem. So we usually tell our students, in real life, you have to go out. We cannot spray with salt water and you'll experience a marine ecosystem. You have to go where the action is, and that's where we take them. So here we have our cave ecology students visiting the cave environs. So our students taking cave ecology are required to learn to rappel. Even the faculty rappel, because we go through cave entrances that are 30 feet. Sir, kailangan din po namin ng insurance na malaki-laki. Kasi it's a dangerous job. And this is where the learning begins. So notice our students are very happy. Kasi they're actively engaged, they're exposed to high oxygen because they're not trapped inside the classroom, so they think clearly. And yes, we do have handouts, we do have manuals, but it does not stop us from providing them with a different type of learning strategy. So here we have a photo of my colleague, Prof. Maranan, holding a caprahircus or a goat, because the goat we use for simulating age structure. So we bring them to the College of Agriculture. We tell our students, today we are hacienderos. So punta kayo doon, you ride the goat, you open their mouth, count the number of teeth, and determine their age, and construct their age structure. See if your guard is actually taking your goats, or if your goat population is increasing or decreasing. So ito po yung ginagawa nila. But sometimes, if we have several sections, the goats get tired. So by the 4 p.m. class, the goats don't anymore run around, they simply open their mouths. So, as an alternative activity, we went to Laguna Lake and collected yung tulya po. And then we used that also as an alternative activity for age structure. So we measure the size of the shell. So we are in a good environment to provide indigenous materials for learning. And we also make use of antlions. This will be my lecture for this afternoon. And bees from the UPLBB program. So if you get stung, you get bonus points of 10 points. That is if you survive that afternoon. So this is the reason why I have tons of energy in class. And I take my job very seriously, as do my colleagues. So this is an ode to our program.
What you are about to witness is scientifically authentic. It is just one step ahead of present-day reality and two steps ahead of present-day sexiness. Prepare yourself to attempt to conceive an inconceivable outer space adventure. Brace yourself for something so fantastically fantastical, you'll soil yourself from intergalactic excitement. Get ready to...
And this, ladies and gentlemen, is why I love teaching. So for this afternoon, my lecture is on doodlebugs. Does anyone know what doodlebugs are? So I think by the end of this lecture, you'll be close to them. So the title of my lecture for this afternoon is Exploring Key Attributes of Populations Using Doodlebugs. Okay, so our expected learning outcomes is to discuss three key attributes of population, namely population size, population density, and spatial distribution or dispersion pattern. Usually, our students are asked to observe an actual doodlebug population. So before coming to class, we ask them to collect at least 30 individuals. And that they use this in order to demonstrate population size, population density, and dispersion pattern. Okay, so when we look at population size, it is affected by four demographic processes. When we say population size, this would be the number of individuals comprising a population. So this is affected by natality, immigration, mortality, and emigration. So the effect of demographic processes, specifically mortality, is more aptly shown through a survivorship curve. So if you look at it this way, insects have a type 3 survivorship curve, meaning many of its members die at an early age. That is because there's very little parental care. In contrast to that, humans have a type 1 survivorship curve. Why? Because we have very high parental care. Di po ba sa Pilipinas, may asawa na nakatira pa rin sa mga magulang? Very high parental care. This is an age structure, another depiction of the effects of demographics on population. So if you notice, what comprises the base of our population? 0 until around 15 to 19. So these are the pre-reproductive stages. So we expect our population to still grow. And the implications for that would be we'd be needing, sir, again, more classrooms, and then more food, and then, sir, again, more classrooms. And if you look at it this way, both the males and the females are equally proportion. So that means if you still don't have a date tomorrow, there is hope. 1:1 pa din siya, oh. So hindi pa po tayo nauubusan ng lalaki, ladies. Can still hunt for them. Okay. So let's move on to another key feature, which is population density. So this would be a number of individuals comprising a population in a particular area. Okay, so in theory, if we have, for example, 1 square kilometer of space and each dot represents one individual, and this individual, for some miracle, reproduces all by himself, by 2050 or after 45 years, it would look something like this. Although in reality, there are dense areas because of dispersion. The availability of nutrients and resources determine how organisms in a population are distributed. So in this case, it could be clumped. In artificial ecosystems, you make it uniform in order for lessening competition. And there's also random distribution. Okay, so remember, our third outcome is to apply these key features in a doodlebug population. So how do we search for doodlebugs? We make into a doodle search. So doodlebugs or milmilyon angustipenis, this was first described by Dr. Banks from UP Los Baños. So historical accounts, the type locality is Los Baños. So they get their namesake from the manner by which they move around in sandy soil. So they look like doodles or scribbles in your notebook. Especially when you're bored to death with the lecture, that's what you do. You scribble, you doodle. You also call them ant lions, or in Filipino, kutong lupa. Diba maaalala yung sa mga teleserye, kutong lupa ka lang. Sabihin nilang ganon. So you're actually referring to doodlebugs. They are actually sit and wait predators that feed on anything they could latch onto. Mostly ants that fall into their sandy pits. So when you're hunting for them, I'll show you a video of the materials that you need. Okay, so they look like this one. My colleagues at the back will be showing you actual specimens of doodle bugs. Can you bring these specimens to the front? Mga nagagandahang binibini po sa likod. So you'll be needing a hand trowel later on, a kitchen sifter, so normal materials that you can find easily in the kitchen. So they're really very small, kaya po sila kutong lupa. And they're not really dead, but they pretend to be dead so that they look like rocks. Nagpapatay-patayin lang po sila. Okay, and you will use match boxes to separate them from one another. You can also make use of lens containers to separate them, or yung medicine boxes, just to make sure that they are separate. You find a sandy soil as they construct pits there. So you can find them beside buildings. Naalala niyo po ba nung bata kayo, you were catching ant lions? Were there any memories of you playing with ant lions? You take a piece of your hair and you try to fish them out. So, wala. So actually, that is a good test also to determine if your potential mate has ano male pattern baldness. Pabunutin mo siya ng pabunutin ng buhok. Kung hindi pa siya tubuan after ano, wag niyo na pong pakasalan. Kasi kawawa po yung mga susunod niyo anak. Oo, imbitahan nyo, Valentine's Day, olika, date tayo. Let's collect ant lion. So, hair daw eh, sabi ni ma'am, hair daw ang gamitin. Oh, there's also a useful characteristic. If your potential or your date or potential mate cannot even catch an ant lion, so don't expect him to catch your attention. Kasi kailangan ng patience, ng ano, eye for details, di ba? So kapag wala siya, no, reject na natin. Okay, so let's summarize the procedure. You find a sandy spot, sift them out, and then put them in sand-filled containers. So how do we show population size? Once they are in the boxes or in the containers, they make pits after 24 hours. So you simply count them. In this case, the population size is how many? Initially, it was 20, but after 24 hours, it was 13 because the 7 were cannibalized. Kaya you have to keep them in separate containers. For population density, you know that you have to indicate the area. If your observation box is 20 by 20 centimeters, you multiply it by the initial number of individuals, then you have around 5 doodle bugs per centimeter squared. The last key feature of the population is dispersion pattern. So you have the nearest neighbor technique developed by Clark and Evans. So all you need to do is to mark each other, each ant lion. So for ant lion 6 and 7 and 6 and 5, the closest neighbor of ant lion 6 is 7 because they are only 3 centimeters apart. You can do this with a simple plastic sheet and mark the individuals at the center of their pits. Okay, here are highlights of the results of our students. So there are values. These are computed statistics. I'll provide you with the references. If your R, for example, is approaching 2.149, as in this case, that means the distribution pattern is uniform. So they have uniform distribution pattern to avoid competition because, again, they are cannibalistic. You use C to determine the degree of departure from randomness. If, for example, you have a C value above 2.58, that means there's a significant departure from randomness. Your only choice is to have clumped or uniform distribution. In this case, you go back to your R values, determining that indeed the distribution pattern of this doodle bug is uniform. For the complete details, you can read our publication. It is an open publication at the Asian Journal of Biological Sciences. And you can also use doodle bugs for other experiments, such as the size affect their dispersion pattern. Or if you provide them with food, will there still be interspecific competition for space? So you can develop different problems for your students. If you still want additional details for this, you can also join our Bio150 group. This semester is Bio150 F2S 2014, and this is our group code. So we'll involve you with our class activities. So good afternoon po. Ito po yung aking lecture.
Thank you, Dr. Dupo. Dr. Dupo has demonstrated that a happy work environment makes a well-motivated professor. Our last finalist is Iris Thiel Iseptan, Associate Professor 4 at the Medical Informatics Unit of the College of Medicine in UP, Manila. Dr. Iseptan has been teaching in UP since 2004. She is a medical doctor specializing in internal medicine, endocrinology, and health informatics. Her presentation and lecture is for the course HI-201, Health Informatics. Please join your hands for Dr. Iris Thiel Iseptan.
So, good afternoon. I am Dr. Iris Thiel Iseptan. I'm from the College of Medicine, UP Manila. I teach HI-201, Health Informatics. So the MS Health Informatics program has two tracks. It has the Medical Informatics and the Bioinformatics track. It is a joint program of the UP College of Medicine and the UP College of Arts and Sciences in UP Manila. It is the only master's program in health informatics in the Philippines. Let me start with a concept map of HI-201. HI-201 is an introductory course to health informatics. So this is what I teach. So health informatics is a tool for global health and e-health. It has influenced the development of the field of health informatics in the Philippines. It transforms health information systems in developing countries through IT governance and management, enterprise architecture, and healthcare. That's the first 5 weeks. Health informatics solves electronic health records issues and challenges. It leads to personal health records. It requires standards and interoperability for both electronic health records and personal health records to actually work. And it prompts clinical decision support. We both need knowledge management and information retrieval because personal health records and electronic health records generate data. So this is the next 5 weeks. Health informatics magnifies the need for privacy, confidentiality, security, and trust, because it engenders also legal and regulatory issues in e-health. That's the next 2 weeks. Health informatics enables technology for telehealth, mHealth, and gamification for health. That is the last 3 weeks. So, why should students study health informatics? I hope the sound will work, because this is a movie I made to advertise my course. I've divided my presentation this afternoon into three parts. So first, I will talk about my teaching philosophy, how I want to make learning visible. Then I will explain why I ask my students to share what they learn on social media. And lastly, how I'm able to put it all together using the university virtual learning environment, or UVLE, where I blend learning and engage my students. So we teach. We all assume that when we teach, students learn. But are they really learning? I want to see them learning. I want to make learning visible. So project-based learning is the act of learning through identifying a real-world problem and developing its solution. Kids show what they learn as they journey through the unit and not just at the end. Heather says further that PBL couches lessons in a tale about a problem that must be solved or an activity that must be developed. The learning happens along the way towards the presentation of the solution. The PBL does not replace content, it creates a vehicle in which to communicate your content. So to go with project-based learning, the teacher must formulate an effective driving question. For the teacher, the driving question serves to initiate and focus the inquiry. It captures and communicates the purpose of the project. For the students, the driving question guides the project work and answers the question, why are we doing this? It creates interest and a feeling of challenge so that even the most reluctant student will think, I guess that sounds kind of cool. To answer the driving question, it is often necessary to answer first some directed and then some open-ended questions. Directed questions are based on facts, have one correct response, and support the development of deeper understanding. Open-ended questions are based on concepts or ideas and have at least one correct answer. Driving questions require research, investigation, and reflection, and call on a student's previous knowledge and encourages multiple approaches to problem solving. So, for example, for week two, I have made this driving question: what is the relevance of informatics to global health and e-health? And to answer that, the students must first answer, what is informatics? What is global health? What is e-health? That's the directed question. And then progress to elucidating how global health is actually related to e-health, or informatics to global health and e-health. Those are the open-ended questions that they have to grapple with before finally answering the driving question. So as a teacher, I have made driving questions for all of those concepts that I showed you earlier. There are assigned readings weekly, and I've also included videos. Going through the material will help the students answer the directed question and then perhaps begin to understand the open-ended question. Deeper thinking is needed to be able to answer the driving question, and I call that instructional scaffolding. Over the past years, I've refined and I'm still refining the driving questions for the topics in HI 201, keeping in mind that a good driving question requires research, investigation, and reflection. My course supports the new competences for learning by Sanders: inquiry, production, participation, and digital literacy. Inquiry, it means finding the right information at the right time. It requires skills in developing appropriate research strategies and to actually evaluate the quality of information that is retrieved. I provide a list of reading materials every week, but often the students will Google for more material to be able to answer my very tough driving question. I expect students not only to be consumers of information, but active producers. So I ask students to submit an assignment to reflect their answer to the driving question. The internet offers unrivaled opportunities for active participation between users, which I take advantage of in this course. Digital literacy considers privacy and copyright along with the freedom afforded by the internet. So for example, for week 9, personal health records, the driving question is, what features are considered critical or most useful by users of personal health records? The assignment is to actually sign up for a personal health record online or to try using a mobile personal health record app. The students are then to create a scoring system to evaluate the usefulness of personal health records and publish that on their blog. So how do students demonstrate the competences for learning? Inquiry. They not only need to find, a personal health record service online or an app, but because there are many, they have to choose one. Second, participation. They actually sign up for that service or try the app. And production, they have to create the scoring system. And for digital literacy, they have to write a review of the online service or the app in their blog. Because they are going to enter their own personal health information on this app or on this online service, I also ask them to examine the privacy and confidentiality agreements for that website. I've set up the driving questions and I provided material for the students to focus their efforts in answering the driving question, but I still need to see how they actually answer the question. In Bloom's taxonomy, we go from lower order to higher order thinking skills: remembering, understanding, applying, analyzing, evaluating, and creating. Because these are graduate students, I expect them to have higher order thinking skills, evaluating, and creating. There is already a digital equivalent to Bloom's taxonomy, and creating would include blogging, commenting, reviewing, posting, moderating, collaborating, and networking would be under evaluating. My teaching has been influenced when I took this MOOC, a Coursera offering entitled E-Learning and Digital Cultures, where the students are asked to examine how e-learning practices are reflected in popular culture. For example, how is e-learning represented in the film The Matrix? These are digital artifacts in our movies. So as a MOOC requirement, the students produce their own digital artifacts that address a course theme, which suggests that the author understands a key concept, and that the choice of media should be appropriate for the message, and that the artifact should stimulate a reaction, either emotion, thinking, or action. I wanted my own HI201 students to actually produce digital artifacts via their blogs. So on the very first week, that's what they do in my class. They start a blog, they write about their course expectations. For some weeks, I merely ask them to answer the driving question via a blog post. But for other weeks, I have them describe the process of producing the product that they are asked to do. For example, they are asked to evaluate the telehealth bill, or to make a scoring system for a personal health record, or create a master plan for hospitals to actually have standards and interoperability, or to propose an app idea for primary healthcare, or evaluate a game app for health. I've also asked them to make concept maps, like what I showed you, an infographic, a mind map, and also a slide presentation that I asked them to upload on slideshare.net. Now, my students are either doctors, pharmacists, or nurses. They are not digital designers. But I am proud to show to you today some of my students' work. These are the infographics that they produced for their week 3 assignment in HI201. If you look at the bottom of the page, you can see the URL. So you will see the link to their blog post documenting how they actually accomplished the assignment, the story behind the infographic. Some of the students just use PowerPoint because that's what they know, but others actually invested time in learning new software freely available online to create their infographic. So infographics are graphic visual representations of information, data, or knowledge intended to present complex information quickly and clearly. When my students make these, I feel I have made their learning visible. So I agree with Jenny Luca when she says there are 5 reasons why students should write blogs and essentially create an e-portfolio. First, it creates positive digital footprints. Employers will now Google applicants for work. The e-portfolio that my students create on their HI201 blog actually cultivates their personal brand. Communicating with digital tools, maintaining a blog acquaints students with HTML code, tagging, and widgets beyond what they would actually have learned by just posting their ideas on Facebook. Transparency. Health informatics is a shiny new concept I still struggle to explain even to my own husband. The blogs are one way for the students